There are some cars that instantly put a very wide smile on your face, and this car is one of them. This is not the regular i20. The i20, the new one, was launched a few months back, and even that in its stock form is an extremely good product. The dynamic capabilities are really nice, and it has stretched the boundaries that much further. It is one of the most pleasurable drives from behind the wheel, and before that, the i20 was just about average. It wasn't really an enthusiast's car. That title really belonged to the Polo GT or even the Baleno RS to a certain extent. But when Hyundai came in with the latest i20, things changed. And now they have this car that I'm driving. It is the i20 N-Line. Now, one must remember that this is not the proper full-blown N-Performance model. That is a very, very different product that has massive, massive performance inputs, like engine has been worked on. There are some beautiful aero bits as well. And the suspension is completely revised. So this is not that product. But there are a little bit of changes, a lot of them being cosmetic and some being focused on more involvement and a little bit better or a more involving drive. The kind of buyer for this car is very different to a typical hatchback buyer, and also slightly different from the regular i20 buyer. Of course, you know, you expect that. A person who's more lifestyle oriented and very individualistic sorts. These are the official terms. And I completely agree, because the kind of driving experience that you get when you're sat in the i20 and you're cutting it down is very different to the stock i20, because a couple of things are very, very crucial over here to note. The power output remains the same, so it's the same 120 bhp odd that you get from the engine. But the way things are from the dynamic perspective are very different. But I'll come to that later, because a lot of buyers buy such kind of a product for the visual appeal, and the i20 N-Line has separated itself from the i20 in a very defined manner. And the one thing that I really like is the fact that it has proper, discreet also at the same time, but very proper, very nicely highlighted red accents. In fact, when you see the i20 coming towards you, that red accent at the bumper, or right at the bottom of the bumper, really makes it look like it's even more hunkered down, it's even more pointier. And the standard i20 itself is a very aggressive design, but with this subtle addition, or a change rather, it just changes the stance of the car on the road, and it looks a lot more planted, a lot more lowered sort of a product. And I think on the road it just looks fantastic. I'm still not a very big fan of the chrome strip that runs at the back. I think that should have been done away with, and Hyundai should have given us a proper matte finish black element over there. Chrome is just too garish to my liking, especially because you have a car which is all black on the inside. There are some very nice dulled out or dark elements on the outside as well. The wheels are phenomenal, and that chrome really stands out. It just does not kind of gel with the overall aesthetic of the car. And the i20 N-Line also comes in some special colors. I really like the white we have had in the media fleet over here, and it does look extremely striking. But I believe that there's a very special gray that they have. That with the red accents is going to be absolutely phenomenal on the road. It is going to be that one special color, I believe, which is going to be a standout element. I would have really wanted brighter colors, like the blue that we have is a very deep blue. Had it been something a lot more sporty, it would have really made it stand out in the crowd. And probably a yellow i20 N-Line would have been phenomenal. But then again, you know, these are colors that don't sell, so I absolutely don't think that would have been a very wise decision. Now, the cabin is essentially just stock when it comes to the design part. Everything that you see, you feel, everything is just i20. The quality levels are pretty decent. I have actually driven the i20, the standard one, for a decent number of kilometers, and nothing really started rattling in here or was being a bother. And I expect the same quality levels to continue in this one as well. But there might be a little bit of a translation of the road into the cabin, because the suspension is definitely stiffened up. The damping is 30% stiffer than the stock i20, and you also feel a lot more heft in the steering wheel. The servo probably is retuned to give you a more direct feel and a little bit more confidence inspiring as well when you're piloting it. But to set the cabin of the i20 inline apart from the stock i20, which is also very dark inside, are these red accents. So you get the red accents on the seats, the control knobs, the door panels, and thankfully it's not overdone, because a lot of times you've seen manufacturers, including Hyundai actually, they've just become too obsessed with giving splashes of different colors, and it just does not work. Thankfully in the i20 inline it definitely works, because the inserts are subtle and the colors are not too loud. So that red with the entire dashboard being black, the whole car being black on the inside, really does work. And surely enough, it's a sporty enough feeling inside. So in terms of practicality, the i20 inline is definitely going to be a good experience. You get decent space in the front. The seats are very, very good. They hold you properly in place. The material that they have for the upholstery is also superb. There is just no way that you're going to slide it around, or even when you're throwing the car in some bends, it is going to definitely hold you in place. So the grip from the material itself is superb. Definitely going to be a little different in terms of the comfort factor. The suspension is stiffened up, as I said. So that will definitely make a little bit of a difference, but how much is something that we'll have to really test with a full load. Right now it's just a couple of us with some luggage, so we can't really measure that, but definitely not going to be as plush a ride. Not that i20 anyway is a plush car when it comes to the suspension, but with the i20 N-Line, that factor is definitely going to be on the firmer side of things. It's a great compromise, because when you get into the buying mode for an i20 N-Line or any such performance product, you know that there are going to be compromises that you will make, and that is exactly what you want and you live with. So the compromises that you make over here are basically comfort, and it's not such a bad thing, because even when you're going about at regular speeds, the suspension is not too bad, come to think of it. It's only when you really start gunning it, when you really start stretching the legs of the car and you encounter some expansion joints or some very scratchy surfaces, that you do feel that 30% stiffness in the suspension. I'm not saying that at slow speeds you can't feel the stiffness. You definitely can, but it's not something that is going to be a deal breaker for you. It's not a ride quality that is very uncomfortable. It's not. It's genuinely something that you will live with, and you feel all that connectedness from the road. You feel what the road is trying to tell you, and that's always a good thing, because it gives you that much more confidence when you're driving, say, at a decent clip. So that is a good thing. Slow speed ride quality is okay, manageable and good. High speeds on some broken surfaces or expansion joints, as I said, that's where you feel all that stiffness. In terms of features, the i20 has always been a very loaded car right from the beginning, and the latest generation model just pushes that envelope even more, and the i20 N-Line continues that. So you get everything right from Android Auto, Apple CarPlay, which has become very, very regular items now, to wireless charging, to every other connected car feature. All these kind of things are there. So in terms of features, you're not really going to miss out on anything at all. Plus, there is a good amount of safety net as well. Active and passive, you have airbags and all the electronic aids. So that is also done very nicely, as is expected by Hyundai. But I have been stretching the legs of the car a fair bit, as I said. And one little element that is common to all the Hyundais, I don't know why that problem exists, but the calibration of the ABS is not the most ideal that you would want. It kind of senses the lock almost happening and then gets in actuation. So I think if the calibration was a lot more progressive, it would have been much nicer. But we get now disc brakes on all four wheels. So the pedal modulation, the bite and the progression, they're all pretty sorted. The pedal feel is genuinely slightly different from the i20, and that is something I sensed immediately after driving it, because there is this sense of good travel but at the same time sufficient amount of bite as well as you keep traveling. It's not like an on and off switch, so there is a good amount of progression, good amount of feel from the pedal as well, and you get that bite point, the strong bite point exactly where you want, that is slightly deeper into the travel. And that is exactly what kind of gives you the confidence when you're throwing the car around, because you know that if you tap the brakes just slightly, it is going to move around according to the feed of the steering wheel that you give into the corners. But if you really have to stomp on the brakes, that means the bite point is going to come at that level and you're going to be really slowing down. So in terms of the brakes being your friend when you are driving in an excited way, that's a very good thing. But the i20 N-Line is all about the way it drives, and that's what all the hype is all about. And it definitely is a very different experience from the standard i20. The steering has great amount of feel, good heft as well as you gain speed. And at slow speeds, it's completely fine. You will be happy living with it. There is a little difference, of course, but something that you're not even going to feel much. But the highlight the real essence of the N-Line hides in the way it turns. When you rush through some nice, fast, flowing bends, you feel that the load transfer on the suspension is very, very smart, very accurate, and the car really doesn't buckle at all. So it's very immediate as well, because the front end is very communicative and it gives you all the feedback that you want and then some. The steering system, as I said, is very responsive. All that coupled to some very decent tires makes it a very rewarding experience. So the i20 N, whether you should buy it or not, well, if you want performance with very acceptable levels of comfort, good practicality and all the features, absolutely, go for it. The thing in terms of looks, I don't know, you know, I'm not going to talk about looks much because that's a subjective matter and people get divided on that. I think the i20 looks pretty all right, and in this shape, the new i20 shape, it actually fits the N-Line and the N a lot more than the standard model, because that whole edgy sort of a design, it matches the credentials of this sort of a product which has a lot of sporty pretensions and a little bit of sporty performance as well.